Ladies and gentlemen, please stand for the national anthem of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago. Take your seats. Good evening, ladies, gentlemen, students, and welcome. My name is Nicole Crooks, and I'm the senior manager with responsibility for the human resource and external relations functions at the bank. On behalf of the board of directors, management, and staff of the central bank, it gives me great pleasure to welcome you to the 30th lecture of the Dr. Eric Williams Memorial Lecture Series. We are truly honored tonight by the presence of Dr. the Honorable Keith Rowley, Prime Minister of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago, and Mrs. Sharon Rowley, the Honorable Justice Ivor Archie, Chief Justice of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago, and Mrs. Denise Rodriguez Archie, members of the Cabinet of Trinidad and Tobago, the Honorable Orville London, Chief Secretary, Tobago House of Assembly, Your Excellencies and Heads of Missions and other members of the Diplomatic Corps, members of the Judiciary, Parliamentary Secretaries, Vice President of the Senate, Deputy Speaker of the House of Representatives, Secretaries of the Tobago House of Assembly, Mayors of City Corporations, Professor Sir Hilary Beckles, Vice Chancellor of the University of the West Indies, and our distinguished lecturer, Mrs. Sheila Hilaire, spouse of the Governor of the Central Bank of Trinidad and Tobago, former Governors of the Central Bank, Dr. Urich Bob and Mr. T. Ainsworth Harewood, former Deputy Governors of the Central Bank, Dr. Shelton Nichols and Mrs. Janice Christopher Nichols, family and friends of Dr. Eric Williams, members of the media, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. Last and by no means least, I wish to extend warm greetings to the students and teachers from Holy Faith Couva and Queen's Royal College, and to the members of the public who are enjoying the live stream of the lecture via the bank's website. It would be remiss of me if I didn't acknowledge Mrs. Erica Williams-Connell and Mrs. Pamela Williams, who expressed their regrets at not being able to be present tonight due to prior commitments. Erica and Pamela, I'm hoping that you tuned into the live feed. As you know, the bank attaches great significance to the Dr. Eric Williams Memorial Lecture Series as part of our corporate social responsibility agenda. In fact, this is the bank's annual flagship event where we highlight the invaluable contribution of our first Prime Minister to the development of Trinidad and Tobago, and indeed, to the region and to the world. To mark this significant occasion, the external relations team felt that apart from the lecture that we are all eagerly awaiting, we would open an exhibition which would seek to capture all the previous EWL lecturers in one space with an excerpt from each of their presentations. It is our way of paying tribute to all these outstanding speakers who made our flagship event a resounding success year after year. It is also our way of saying thank you to the former governors for continuing the legacy of our first Prime Minister. We are thrilled to open our exhibition entitled Celebrating 30 Years of Caribbean Scholarship, the Eric Williams Memorial Lecture Series, 1983 to 2016. For those of you who are quick at math, you would have already recognized that this does not add up to 30 years. And this is because the bank did not host lectures for a four-year period. But once reintroduced, it has been on the bank's annual calendar ever since. I dare say without arrogance that this lecture series is one of the longest running and most distinguished in Trinidad and Tobago and the Caribbean. Our exhibition also features images and artifacts that were graciously loaned to us from the Eric Williams Memorial Collection, which is housed at the Alma Jordan Library at the University of the West Indies. In addition, we are very excited about the replica of the gazebo from the University of Woodford Square, the platform from which Dr. Williams gave many memorable speeches to the nation. You will be able to step into the gazebo and listen via an audiovisual display to some of these speeches. I guarantee you all that you will enjoy the exhibition as much as we have enjoyed creating the experience for you. You will have the privilege of experiencing it first. And to the viewing public, we welcome you during weekdays from 8 a.m. to 4 p.m. from July 25th to August 30th to come out in your numbers to view the exhibition. I now invite our esteemed governor, Dr. Alvin Hilaire, to give opening remarks and to introduce our distinguished speaker for tonight's 30th Dr. Eric Williams Memorial Lecture. Thank you.
Thank you, Nicole, and welcome to the Central Bank of Trinidad and Tobago. Dr. the Honorable Keith Rowley, Prime Minister of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago, and Mrs. Sharon Rowley. The Honorable Justice Ivo Archie, Chief Justice of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago, and Mrs. Denise Rodriguez Archie, members of the Cabinet of Trinidad and Tobago, the Honorable Orville London, Chief Secretary Tobago House of Assembly, Your Excellencies, Heads of Missions, and other members of the Diplomatic Corps, members of the Judiciary, Parliamentary Secretaries, Vice President of the Senate, Deputy Speaker of the House of Representatives, members of the Senate and of the House of Representatives, secretaries of the Tobago House of Assembly, permanent secretary to the Prime Minister and head of the public service, and other permanent secretaries, mayors of city corporations, Professor Sir Hilary Beckles, Vice Chancellor of the University of the West Indies, and our distinguished lecturer, board of directors, management, and staff and retirees of the Central Bank of Trinidad and Tobago, former governors of the Central Bank, Dr. Urich Bob and Mr. T. Ainsworth Harewood, former deputy governors of the Central Bank, Mr. Jerry Hospitalis, Ms. Joan John, Dr. Shelton Nichols, and Mrs. Janice Christopher Nichols, family and friends of Dr. Eric Williams, students and teachers from Holy Faith Convent, Couva and Queen's Royal College, Port of Spain, members of the media, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of the Board of Directors, the management, and staff of the Central Bank of Trinidad and Tobago, I am very pleased to welcome you to the Dr. Williams Memorial Lecture for the year 2016. Welcome to all of you in our audience tonight at the Central Bank and those sharing in the proceedings via the internet or on television or radio. I thank you for your physical or your virtual presence at this, the flagship event of the bank's annual calendar. As many of you are aware, tonight is a major milestone in the history of this event. In the 52 years of the Central Bank's existence, this is the 30th edition of this distinguished lecture series. I believe we can be justifiably proud of this achievement in honoring the work and contribution of Dr. Eric Eustace Williams. Dr. Williams is a leader who took the country to independence and whose scholarship and point of view set the tone for early development as a nation and our interaction with our Caribbean and Latin American neighbors and the world at large. As you know, Dr. Williams was our first Prime Minister. But more than that, he was a compelling and inspiring Caribbean leader and a noted historian and intellectual on the world stage. Through this series of lectures, the Central Bank has consistently confirmed its commitment to public education, as this is an area that was of utmost significance to Dr. Williams in his quest for the development of his country, our nation, Trinidad and Tobago. Over the 30 editions of this lecture, the bank has exposed the public to the ideas of noted intellectuals and experts, covering a wide range of topics in many, many fields, such as economics, politics, sociological issues, ethnicity, health concerns, and cultural matters. We are particularly pleased to expose our young people who would have been born after the passing of the doctor, as he was known, to this rich tradition of scholarship. We have heard, among others, over the years of the production from the likes of Nobel laureate in economics, Sir W. Arthur Lewis, in the inaugural lecture in 1983, former UN Secretary General Dr. Javier Perez de Cuellar, Professors Carrie Leavitt and Kenneth Ramchan, the Right Honorable Mr. Justice P. Telford Georges, Professor Amartya Sen, who was awarded the Nobel Prize in Economics in 1998, Professor Kenneth Julian, former Prime Minister of Jamaica, the Most Honorable P.J. Patterson, Professor Arnold Rampersad, and author Rachel Manley, daughter of the former Prime Minister of Jamaica, Michael Manley. And last year, we were honored with the presentation of Dr. Selwyn Carrington, who talked on the very intense topic of ethnicity and leadership in the Caribbean. These are just a few of the many distinguished lecturers to have graced this very stage. And in this regard, as Nicole mentioned, we have a special treat for you tonight. Well, actually, we have two treats. One is the special public exhibition just outside of this hall that features all of those presenters who have shared with us their perspectives on this stage. And you'll have the opportunity to see the images and quotations from their speeches. The other treat, of course, is tonight's lecture itself. We have the distinct pleasure of having with us to present this year's lecture a man who is no stranger to anyone who has been in touch with Caribbean news and issues over the past decade, and even more. In his lectures and writings, Professor Hilary Beckles, now Sir Hilary Beckles, has been outspoken on topics ranging from Caribbean development and culture to West Indies cricket, reparations from the transatlantic slave trade, and very recently on the potential Caribbean response to the UK's so-called Brexit referendum vote. Sir Hilary is a Barbadian scholar with impeccable credentials, both as an academic and as an administrator at university level. He was appointed Vice Chancellor of the University of the West Indies in 2015. I must say that the UWI was my alma mater. So this is, I want to send a special shout out to the sisters and brethren of the University of the West Indies and all the campuses throughout the region. Before then, Sir Hilary held the posts of principal and pro-vice chancellor of the university's Cahill campus in Barbados between 2002 and 2015. Sir Hilary has distinguished himself as an economic historian and specialist in higher education and development thinking and practice. He is chairman of the CARICOM Reparations Commission, vice president of the International Task Force for the UNESCO Slave Route Project, an advisor to the UN World Culture Report, and a member of the UN Secretary General's Science Advisory Board on Sustainable Development. Among his numerous other roles in service to the Caribbean, Sir Hilary is founder and director of the CLR James Center for Cricket Research at Cahill Campus and a former member of the West Indies Cricket Board. Moreover, he's the founder and inaugural chairman of the High Performance Cricket Academy of the West Indies Cricket Board and also vice president of the Commonwealth Sports Minister's Advisory Body on Sport and Development. In 2007, Sir Hilary was made a Commander Knight of St. Andrew, which is Barbados's highest national honor. This award was made in recognition of his distinguished contribution in the field of education, particularly at university level. and his dedication to the furtherance of the arts and sports, especially in cricket. This evening, it is with great pleasure that I invite Sir Hilary Beckles to deliver the 30th Dr. Eric Williams Memorial Lecture on the theme, the university sector and economic development in the Caribbean. Thank you very much.
Dr. the Honorable Keith Rowley, my friend, Prime Minister of this remarkable republic, and Mrs. Rowley, the Honorable Justice Ivor Archie, Chief Justice of the Republic, and Mrs. Archie, members of the Williams family, members of the Cabinet, our Chief Secretary, the Honorable Orville London, Excellencies of the Diplomatic Corps, members of the Judiciary, Parliamentary Secretaries, Vice President of the Senate, Deputy Speaker of the House of Representatives, members of the Senate and House of Representatives, Secretaries of the Tobago House of Assembly, the Mayor of the City Corporations, Dr. Alvin Hilaire, Governor of the Central Bank, and Mrs. Hilaire, former governors of the Central Bank, Dr. Eric Bob and Mrs. Bob and Mr. Haywood, former deputy governors of the Central Bank, families and friends of the Williams family, members of the media, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. What an honor it is for me to be a part of this distinguished series celebrating the legacy of Dr. Eric Williams. I am doubly honored because I have had the pleasure as a young man, as a graduate student, to engage Dr. Williams. My own research as a graduate student was based entirely upon the work of Dr. Williams. In fact, if you reflect upon his seminal work, Capitalism and Slavery, I think it's the first or second chapter in that monograph is entitled The Origins of Negro Slavery. And in that chapter, he argued that Caribbean entrepreneurs of the 17th century had a choice of multiple forms of labor to use in the development of the Caribbean plantation system. But by the middle of the 17th century, they chose enslaved African labor, and it was a rational market choice based on price and supply considerations. He argued it had very little to do with Europeans' attitudes to the enslavement of Africans, but it was fundamentally a market choice. My own PhD dissertation was an econometric model to establish and support the validity of the Williams thesis, simply because there had been 30 years of criticisms of that argument, suggesting instead it was endemic racism within European culture that led to the choice. My econometric model, based on price, supply, and demand considerations, sought to establish the veracity of the Williams thesis. And so, therefore, my first academic work was based on the Williams thesis. My last book, published 2 years ago, Britain's Black Debt, Reparations Owed the Caribbean World for Enslavement and Native Genocide, was also based on capitalism and slavery, In fact, that work asks the question, having established that Western European capitalism was built fundamentally on the profits and the capital extracted from the Caribbean plantation system, which were used to finance the industrial transformation of Britain especially and also the other European countries. What if Williams had taken that argument to the next logical conclusion? The next logical conclusion, therefore, would be that having established the economic growth at a revolutionary level by the use of slavery, which was a crime against humanity, and having perpetuated that system for 300 years, and having used that system to maximum effect to transform the economy, would it not therefore follow that reparatory justice ought to be the next chapter of capitalism and slavery? And that was my position, and on that basis I wrote the book Britain's Black Debt, which in my own imagination was the final chapter of the Williams thesis. But it's also a double pleasure to be here, especially in the company of the Prime Minister and Mrs. Rowley, because we were together in Jamaica at the Mona campus just a few days ago. And I can say to you that what I experienced there at Mona and in Jamaica was a brilliant display of diplomacy and leadership by our Prime Minister, who was able to craft friendship out of fragmentation and hope out of hubris. And I wish again to express my gratitude on behalf of all Caribbean peoples for our Prime Minister defining this moment in developmental terms. That in the end, it is high-level quality diplomacy that will keep this region together and moving forward. I have examined the list of all of the great and distinguished scholars who have made presentation in this series, and I'm happy to say that I have some familiarity with the vast majority of them. But I would wish to mention my own mentor, Sir Alistair McIntyre, my very good friend, Professor Orlando Patterson, and my own intellectual hero, Sir Arthur Lewis and Rex Nettleford. These scholars have all helped me to understand the economic development of this region and why we ought to be impatient with all of the forces and institutions inhibiting its development. Development thinking is a part of my own life. As an economic historian, I have been very impatient with what we call the colonial mess that we have inherited from 300 years of colonial rule. Many contemporary leaders are oftentimes not comfortable to discuss this legacy we have inherited, but as academics, we must insist upon it. We have done very well to craft nation states out of this colonial mess. And we must describe that which we have inherited. You only have to reflect upon the fact that in 1962, when this country declared its independence, as well as Jamaica, that 70% of the people of this region could not read or write. That after 300 years, the colonial powers have left 3/4 of our citizens in a state of illiteracy. We were called upon, therefore, to transform this state into modern economies, to take this colonial mess and out of the rubble, transform them into viable and sustainable nations. The fact is that if we need to understand the origins of the fiscal difficulties we have in today, we must return to this moment. This was the moment when governments came into being, national governments came into being, and determined to advance the condition of their citizens, participated in extremely high levels of social expenditure. That level of social expenditure in education, in health, in housing, in infrastructure, were required to convert colonial beings into citizens. But I'm quite sure that most leaders were fully aware that their economies could not sustain this level of expenditure. But it was necessary in order to create the viability of citizenship. Our countries went into independence without a development program from the British government. In fact, at the end of the colonial period, the Caribbean was experiencing what, in fact, is really the CSME. The 1950s and 1960s, before 1962, there was free movement of labor in the colonies. There was free movement of capital in the colonies. Colonial peoples were moving from colony to colony. Business people were setting up enterprises across the Caribbean. And that was the system which the British had put in place towards the end of their rule. My father traveled from Barbados to this country on several occasions looking for work. My uncles traveled to Guyana looking for work. The Beckles family scattered across the Caribbean looking for work without let or hindrance. The British government did not participate in funding a federation, and with the collapse of the federation, did not develop a plan to assist the transformation of these fledgling nations. They started out, therefore, under very adverse circumstances. I know of no body of economic thought. I know of no system of economic analysis that could have allowed these colonies, within that context, without that support, with massive social decay, to transform themselves into sustainable economies in two or three generations. But a tremendous effort was made, and I think that despite all of the difficulties, despite all of the challenges we are having today, I think we must congratulate ourselves for what we have achieved. This presentation looks at the university sector in this process of history, at the present moment, and where we intend to go in the future. My own journey has been one entirely connected to the university sector. In fact, I went to university at the age of 17, and I have not left. But I was always concerned with the issues of social justice and the issues of economic development. I went off to college to read for a major in philosophy because that was my interest at the age of 17. Within a year, I had changed my major from philosophy to economic history, from one faculty of humanities to a faculty of social sciences. because I realized that I could not comprehend the circumstances facing the people of the developing world, primarily the Caribbean, without a clear understanding of the economic structures in these economies and societies. And so I chose the discipline of economic history because that gave me a better understanding of the historical trajectories of our people and the structures that are in place to govern their realities. I have stayed within the university sector primarily because I believe it has an important and vital role to play in our transformation and development as a people. If I did not believe deeply in that position, I would have chosen another profession. I believe that universities are built to serve nations. They are not built to serve themselves. They are built, funded, and financed so that they may participate in the transformation and the elevation of their communities. Those of us, therefore, who dwell within universities ought to keep that fact squarely within our imagination and allow it to govern all that we do and say. But universities, like all institutions, whether they be systems of governance, political parties, all institutions, must from time to time reinvent themselves, restructure themselves, must reorganize themselves and seek new levels of legitimacy. Legitimacy in all circumstances has a shelf life. You can lose it. It can be taken from you. It is the most precious of gifts that requires ongoing conversations. I would like to imagine that I have been a part of our University of the West Indies over the years in the search of the constant reinvention of itself. In our CARICOM English-speaking subsector, we have some 15 institutions that have been classified as universities. We can speak of a university sector not only in terms of the number of institutions and those employed within them, but all of the connections that these universities have with the rest of the institutions of civil society. While we can speak of a university sector, it is not fair to say that we can speak of a university system, because all of these universities are not interlinked at the level they ought to be. They are not structured to articulate with each other so that academic content and student enrollment can move between all of these systems into a seamless process. We do not have that as yet within our CARICOM world, but that is an ideal that we must pursue. I have the honor at this time of being the president of the Association of Caribbean Universities, which is an organization made up of universities in the English-speaking Caribbean, the Spanish-speaking Caribbean, the French-speaking Caribbean. And as vice chancellors and principals, we use this organization so as to foster the possible and future creation of what we hope will be the Caribbean university system. And we're working towards that. That is a part of my mandate as president. But in all of these societies, the universities are well established. Let us look, therefore, at where we are within this university sector. It has been agonizing of late to engage sociologists around the world who have been arguing that the Caribbean peoples are now a tired and exhausted people. That we are a tired and exhausted culture, and that our golden age is behind us. This argument is based on the assumption that after 400 years of struggle for freedom against slavery, overthrowing indenture, removing ourselves from the colonial structures, building nations out of colonial rubble, maintaining stability and economic growth against that background, that project, or those series of interlocking projects, have exhausted our energy and our capacity. And we have reached the end of a certain kind of line. And now we are floundering. We are drifting through time. That our youth are rudderless. That this is the first generation of young people in the Caribbean who do not have a movement of their own. And in the circumstance of not having a movement of their own, their relationship to society is dominated by cycles of control, repression, and crime. That we have built the nations, and now we do not know where to go. We are without a vision, having built and sustained our nations. Then we have a description of this reality that speaks of increasing poverty, that speaks of the devaluation of our citizenship we have fought for, that speaks to the retreat of our intellectuals and the rise of individualism over nationhood. As you heard, I have a close affinity to cricket. And the great late C.R. Lord James would always say that cricket is just a mirror that reflects the images that are real within our societies. A few years ago, I brought 50 students into my office, a focus group, and I said to those students, I'm going to call the names of the former captains of West Indies cricket, and you must tell me the concept that comes to mind when I call the names. And I said, Sir Frank Worrell, and they said, the father. Gary Sobers, the king. Clive Lloyd, the statesman. Courtney Walsh, ambassador. Brian Lara, the prince. Jimmy Adams, gentleman. And when I came to Chris Gayle, they made a statement, which I will not repeat tonight. Because I have already paid to their a price to repeat what the student said. But the critical point is that we can see the journey over 50 years and the transformation to perceptions of where our societies have reached. I wish to critique this sociological interpretation that I have presented to you. But to do so, I wish to, first of all, establish the centrality of the university sector to everything that we have done and achieved in this region over the last 50 years. When we begin to historicize who we are as a people, our culture, our identity, the journey on which we are on, where we have come from, our multicultural, multiracial formations, the fact that the Caribbean world is the world's first global village because all of the cultures and civilizations of the world have found themselves here to create something entirely unique, a Caribbean civilization. To do that, we go to Eric Williams, we go to El Segafaya. When we sought to understand the economic structures, we were required to transform, to build nations. We came up with the Plantation Economy School that sought to help us to understand our internal and external structures. And to do that again, we went to Beckford, Lloyd Bess, Norman Gervin, all of these UE economists, helping us to understand these structures we had to reform. Then when we came to discuss how best to modernize these economies, to William DeMass McIntyre, UWA economist. Then when we ask ourselves the question, can these systems be reformed or must they be revolutionized? Again, we found ourselves relating to UWA scholars, Walter Rodney, Ralph Gonzalez, and so on. Whatever the paradigm we chose, UWA intellectuals were at the center of the choices being made available to us. As a young man, when I attended the Mona campus, when I went to work there in the late 70s, the university was gripped at the center of a bitter conflict between two bodies of economic thought. Sir Arthur Lewis on the one hand, and the New World economists on the other hand. Sir Arthur Lewis, who we celebrate today as one of our greatest economists, Nobel laureate, back then in UWI, Sir Arthur Lewis was described as a neo-colonial, an Afro-Saxon, a reactionary. He was seen as a scholar who was prepared to maintain the subordination of Caribbean peoples. He was not celebrated within UWA. It was the most extraordinary moment. His wonderful, extraordinary essay, which I'm sure most of you know, that enabled him to win the Nobel Prize, Economic Development with Unlimited Supplies of Labor, how to mobilize the factors of production, how to modernize the Caribbean by attracting direct foreign investment in this region to use the labor to create employment. The concept of unlimited supplies of labor was interpreted by UWI sociologists to mean unlimited supply of cheap labor and cheap laborers, and therefore second-class citizens. That is how the sociologists and the political scientists analyzed the concept of unlimited supplies of cheap labor. It was a time when we had a choice of theorizing the options available to us in this region. There was the Haitian model, which was fundamentally misunderstood by most economists. Then there was the Jamaica model, and then, of course, there was the Barbados model. And this is how these three models were polarized. The Haitian model that sought to confront the Western world to establish the freedom and the revolutionary freedom of the people, giving them the choice to build the nation in their own image. Jamaica, which was seen as a middle ground, where the cultures of Europe and the cultures of Africa were involved in conflict. That conflict has not yet been resolved. And Barbados, where the society, the first plantation economy in the New World, was seen as an outpost of Europe, as the last bastion of European domination in the Caribbean, and that was the model for the future. These choices were available to our economists, our historians, our students. The Haitian model was classified as the worst-case scenario. The Barbados model was considered the best-case scenario. These conversations were taking place throughout academia. How should we proceed? What should we do? Mixed economy, socialist economy, social democracy, free market economy. What were the choices that are before us? How should we proceed? UB scholars were at the center of all choices. There was a view which said that Barbados was the best managed black economy in the world. There was an argument which said, but it isn't a black managed economy. Barbados is the last bastion of racial apartheid in the New World. And there were all of these concepts being formulated of choice. UB scholars were at the center of all of this. But whatever, by the 1990s, all of our economies had crashed under IMF, World Bank, structural adjustment. Within 30 years of independence and development, all of us found ourselves in the same place. The university sector saw itself as being in the vanguard of government choices. Most of our professors worked for governments. They were advisors. They ran the statutory corporations. They sat in the senates. The UWI was in the center of all of these choices across the region. There was tremendous growth and development in the first 20 years. The 70s and 80s were dynamic and exciting and transformational times. We had significant economic growth. We had the emergence of our identities consolidated. There was pride in nationhood. For 20 years, we did very well. When our economies crashed in the 90s, the university community was held responsible for most of it. Within our university, I felt the critique in political and parliamentary circles that the governance process had become too closely aligned to the thinking of UWI scholars. And there was this conflict between the conservative elements in our political discourse and the university community. But I say once again, think of cricket as the mirror. In the 70s and 80s, our cricket did well. We rose up and dominated the world. By the end of the 80s, we were the most powerful cricket force on this planet. In 1995, we lost to Australia at Sabina Park, and our cricket crashed in much the same way that our economies crashed. We went from the top of the cricket world to the bottom of the cricket world in Test cricket in 10 years. So, in a sense, the trajectory of our economies and the trajectory of our cricket were hand in glove. It's important, I believe, to maintain that relationship. I believe that emerging out of the 90s, it became almost endemic to UWI to retreat from public engagement. After 20 to 30 years of intense engagement, the circumstances of the 90s, in my view, led to a retreat. Some of our most distinguished intellectuals who were public advocates became private advisors. Many of our academics entered party politics and into representative government. Many of them were silenced as they became consultants. Some of them spoke of being fearful of the state. There was the demonization of the radical intellectual. There was the emergence in civil society of the paramountcy of the political party. And to some extent, there was a derailment of development discourse. The UWI, in my judgment, is now seeking to reinvent itself and to reestablish that primacy and centrality it once had. And I wish to express the view that institutions do go through these cycles. Economic institutions, political institutions, academic institutions do go through these cycles in search of a new legitimacy. In Jamaica, the turbulence was very intense at the Mona campus. And Jamaica has the region's deepest radical tradition. Trinidad and Tobago has the region's deepest intellectual tradition. And Barbados has the region's deepest educational tradition. But there's a fundamental difference between an educational tradition and an intellectual tradition. Not all educational and intellectual traditions translate themselves into radical traditions. It's for us to understand these fundamental differences, especially given the fact that our three landed campuses are located within these three societies. Barbados, my homeland, is known for its educational pedigree. But rarely does it translate its educational heritage into intellectualism, or indeed into radicalism. These characteristics are embedded in national character. The kind of mind that has emerged in Sierra Leone's Lloyd Bess, V.S. Naipaul, Earl Lovelace, a special kind of mind, intellectual, deeply embedded in an anxiety about change and transformation, the kind of mind that Barbados needs. Barbados produces writers, authors, professors, invariably unwilling or unable to to speak of radical transformation and change. All of our societies have benefited from and paid the price of these fundamental distinctions. Our task within UWI at this moment is to ask the question, what would Dr. Williams expect of UWI today? What would Sir Arthur Lewis expect us to do about our economies? And I believe we ought to keep these two personalities into close relations, because out of the engagement between Dr. Williams and Sir Arthur came the modern UWI. It was Eric Williams and Arthur Lewis, our first vice chancellor, and at the time, Dr. Williams was also pro-chancellor of UWI, who took the decision to transform UWI into a tri-campus university. The university was quite cozy and comfortable at Mona in Jamaica, a one-campus university. All Caribbean folks would travel to Mona to study. Dr. Williams theorized the concept of the tri-campus university, one here in St. Augustine and one in Barbados for the Eastern Caribbean. And that is why in the regulations and ordinances, the CAFL campus was called the UWI in the Eastern Caribbean. It took the name CAFL later on, but that was the concept. A campus for the Eastern Caribbean, a campus for this country, and a campus for Jamaica. Sir Arthur, as the first vice chancellor, his mandate was to implement that strategy. And he did so brilliantly. And now we have a fourth campus, the open campus that binds the region together and the region to the world. It has evolved considerably since those days of Dr. Williams and Sir Arthur. St. Augustine is now our largest campus. I had the pleasure of sharing the statistics with the Prime Minister a few days ago. The people of Jamaica embraced in 1948 this fledgling university. They gave the fledgling university dignity, respect, and with the support of Jamaican people, that campus emerged into a major global institution. And when Mona was the largest campus, a status it carried for 65 years or so, it carried that status with dignity. It is now St. Augustine's turn to carry that status as our largest campus with dignity. It is now the turn of this great country to ensure that St. Augustine provides that vision and leadership. At the moment, there are 20,000 students enrolled at our St. Augustine campus. There are 15,000 students enrolled at our Mona campus. And there are 7,000 students enrolled at our CAFL campus, and 6,000 students enrolled in our open campus. We are, therefore, by international standards, a large university. We are, by international standards, a large university. Some 50,000 students enrolled in all of the disciplines. We are a large university. It is our intention, therefore, to take this enormous investment of taxpayers' money and transform it into an instrument to promote, at this time, the principal development agendas of this region. We have asked ourselves in recent weeks, what are the major challenges facing Caribbean people? And without a doubt, it is that we must generate more wealth in this region. If we do not generate more wealth in this region, all of the sacrifices we have made these past 50 to 60 years, all of the achievements in the social sector and the cultural sector, they will be diminished and eroded. The university, therefore, has to place and will place as its top priority engaging with the process of wealth creation and the equitable distribution of that wealth within the Caribbean world. We are currently involved in strategic planning. We are laying the foundation for our next five-year strategic plan, 2017-2022, and these are the issues foremost on our agenda. We have to identify all of the inhibiting factors holding back our economic development. We have to give top priority to the economic growth agenda. The news is not always encouraging. There is inadequate development of social capital. There is a shortage of critical skills. There is an inadequate innovation culture. And there is undeveloped non-traditional entrepreneurship. These factors combined account for the slow rate of economic recovery. In fact, when we examine the statistics in this hemisphere, we can see that the Caribbean world, and especially the English-speaking Caribbean world, our response to the global recession of 2007-08 is indeed the most sluggish. Even the Spanish-speaking Caribbean, Dutch-speaking Caribbean, are ahead of us in that regard. The English-speaking Caribbean, our subsector in this region, has had the most sluggish response of late. And we know why this is so. We understand the process of inadequate productivity, diminished competitiveness. But in all of these areas, the university sector has a vital role to play. Let us take the most disturbing news of all. Let us take the statistics relevant to the enrollment of our young people in higher education. And we're going to use the UNESCO cohort 18 to 30. If you take the age cohort 18 to 30, we in the English-speaking Caribbean, we have the lowest enrollment in higher education in this entire hemisphere. From Alaska to Argentina, 18 to 30, we in the English-speaking Caribbean, we have the lowest enrollment in higher education. Spanish-speaking Caribbean ahead of us, the French-speaking Caribbean ahead of us, the Dutch-speaking Caribbean ahead of us. There is a relationship between all of these things. This low enrollment, for some people might just be a statistical nicety. But if you put that alongside what we know to be true, that a country's potential for economic change and transformation is a direct relationship between the number of its citizens who have had or are having professional training and higher educational development. If you do not have higher educational development, professional training, broad-based across all disciplines, the potential of your society for transformation and growth are diminished. So the statistics in themselves might not be too exciting to listen to, but the importance of it is the implication of it. It impacts upon the nature of entrepreneurship. It impacts on the innovativeness of the citizens. It impacts upon the cultural creativity of the citizens, because I can tell you, most societies that are developed, you can demonstrate that between 40 to 50% of the citizens are actively engaged in the activities of their societies and cultures. People who wake up every morning and as citizens say to themselves, my contribution today is important to my country. And whatever endeavor I'm located, what I do or do not do will impact my society. I grew up as a teenager in Britain. I attended half of my high school years in Britain. And I was fascinated by the depth of engagement of citizens in the future of their country. Even the younger people, I was quite astonished by the number of people who were engaged in building that sense of nationhood. In many undeveloped and developing nations, that percentage is much smaller. A larger number of disengaged citizens, the society being carried by fewer and fewer people, the bulk of the engagement is a challenge. Universities have an important role to play in turning all of this around. Universities, I believe, have a special responsibility to diagnose and commit to the transformation of these inhibiting consciousness and cultures. Let us take an example of how a campus in itself can be a powerful economic institution. In my years as principal of the KFL campus, the Prime Minister, Mr. Onatha, called me to his office and said, listen to me. I would like you to write a strategic plan for higher education and national development. And I would like the campus to drive the process of transformation. And I would like you to prepare the relevant documentation to inform the strategies of my government about the relationship between education, innovation, and growth. That document was prepared. The document carried a title, One Graduate Per Household, the Vision of the KFL Campus. And it was based on a demographic analysis that showed there were 120,000 households on the island. 20% of them had a student or a graduate. we committed ourselves to 10 years that every household on this island will have at least one graduate of a college or the campus. And to do so, we would have to move the enrollment from 3,000 students to 12,000 students, and that we will grow that enrollment around the concept of the services economy, because Barbados was a services economy, and the growth in the enrollment had to be tracked within the disciplines that would promote the services economy. In other words, the investment and the enrollment had to be linked to the structure of the economy so that those students and graduates would participate in the expansion of that economy and there would be no graduate unemployment. And so we rolled that out. The Barbados economy was growing. There was no graduate unemployment. 80% of our students, of our graduates, were finding a job within 3 months of graduation. Our enrollment were around the issues of management, finance, bank, and tourism. We grew the enrollment in those disciplines to push the economy. Then something remarkable happened. We had the global recession, 2007-08. We had a change of government. The government then argued that the country could not afford such a large campus. Tuition fees were introduced, a whopping 20% without notice. Students who were funded by the state suddenly had to find 20% of their costs. The KFL campus enrollment collapsed from 10,000 to 5,000. It has not recovered. What was once a busy, expansive, and dynamic institution was transformed into a shadow of itself. The question which was asked, and I was invited again by the government to prepare a document on how to introduce tuition fees. I told the Stuart government that I would like a committee made up of the principals of all tertiary institutions. And a committee of 7 persons went to work. We wrote a report in which we argued that tuition fees are necessary. Barbadian citizens had 100% public funding for 50 years. That massive investment is the single most important factor that made Barbados a sustainable economy and society. If there is one institution that reside at the basis of Barbados's transformation, it was the University of the West Indies. That was the foundation on which Barbados emerged. We submitted a report in which we said that it is fair and appropriate that citizens at this moment in time be invited to pay and make a contribution towards their tuition fees. In other words, we do not believe in a philosophy that says students should pay or students should not pay. The question of affordability is important. And in our report, we argued that the society has benefited from the 100% model for 50 years. The massive collapse of public revenues have now made this difficult. And we recommended that tuition fees be phased in over 3 years so that they should pay 10% in the first year, 15% in the second, move into 20% over third, and we will grandfather out the students who are in the system under the prior arrangement, but we will phase in tuition fees gradually to allow the society to become accustomed to the responsibility of some measure of self-funding. That was our recommendation to the government. The government says, no, we're going to go full hog one time. 20% one time. 5,000 students disappeared from the University of the West Indies. For me, this has been my most painful experience as a Caribbean educator. Simply because it comes to the personal level where a student would come and say, Principal, I have 3 kids at Cahill campus. Now, I cannot find 5,000 US, 5,000 US. I cannot find 15,000 US next semester. And bear in mind, you're in a university where 85% of the students are from working class homes. These are not middle class universities. UWI is primarily a working class university. Parents would come and say, well, I am a student at the university, and I have a son or daughter at the university, and one of us have to drop out. Now, the emotional landscape is significant. But then you drill down in the data, and you realize that 75% of the students on the campus are female. Of that 75% who are female, 80% are working class. Of that 80% and 75%, 50% of them are unmarried mothers, working class women with a child trying to get a degree. In every sociological model, the most vulnerable citizen in Caribbean society is an unmarried working class mother. But yet, this was the group where the bulk of the fee fell. And so my position to the government was, if you have a taxation that falls disproportionately on the most vulnerable citizen in the society, the policy cannot be just. In most societies, that would not be considered just. But it was implemented, and the consequences were as predicted. That was the end of that. But we are rebuilding all of our campuses, and we have determined that there are 2 discourses which we must pull together in order to transform this region. 1, the low access to higher education in this region. Many of you have a sense of an ad hoc notion, a large number of students at a college or a campus. But when you see the numbers in relation to the size of the population, then you realize that if you take all the students enrolled in all of the institutions in your country and you express them as a percentage of the population, it is very small indeed. In North America, it is over 50%. It is over 50% in North America. The enrollment of young people between 15 and 30 is almost 50% in North America. Latin America is 35% and rising. In the English-speaking Caribbean, it is less than 15%. In the Windward Islands, our neighbors, It is less than 5%. And this is where we're at. Then we have to marry that with another important historical juncture. Where are we in our economic development? This is the innovation stage. This is the innovation stage of our economies. If you take the economies in the last 50 years, the 50s, 60s, and 70s, we had a competitive advantage around price. Our raw materials were well priced comparatively, we could cope. We had a price advantage. Then in the 80s, 90s, we shifted into services and we developed a quality advantage. No doubt, our tourism sector was one of the finest in the world, quality-wise. Our banking services, our financial services sector, one of the finest in the world. And we had a quality advantage that made us competitive. Then we started to lose both the price advantage and the quality advantage, which explains the sluggishness of the moment, because this is the stage where the innovation factor is the most critical. So we are now at the cusp. We either develop innovative economies or we will continue into economic decline. The transformation into innovative economies require more than ever the importance of the university sector. Requires research, the transformation of research into application. And this is why distinguished wealth creator, entrepreneur in any sector, culture, manufacturing, energy, who with a distinguished record of achievement in this sector, the university will apply its normal criteria and appoint that person as a professor of practice. That professor will then be expected to come to the university and build a bridge between the faculty and the industry. This is a practice which is you will find in many fine universities in the world. This is something that we have to do. We have also created to give effect to the third A, which is agility to global opportunity. We have appointed a pro vice chancellor for global affairs. I wish to emphasize that these are not new positions that we have created with new budgets, because we are committed to reducing the percentage cost of the administration to the overall cost of the institution. These are restructuring positions. We have restructured the senior management to create new positions at the same budget or even at reduced costs. So now we have a pro vice chancellor for global affairs, we have a pro vice chancellor for industry alignment and for economic engagement. These offices will go to work to build these bridges. We have traveled through the world looking for opportunity. We ask ourselves, what is the biggest single challenge our young people are faced with right now? The biggest challenge is to bring the younger generation into the digital world, not just as users for entertainment and fun of the technology, but to develop an affinity for the technology for the purpose of the transformation of that knowledge into innovative self-employment, entrepreneurship, and to create industries for themselves. Software engineering, we have said, is going to be our next frontier. How proud we felt when the president of China came to this country and signed a treaty with CARICOM. Before it was signed, I was seeking a copy of it, because I thought therein must lie opportunities for UWI. And so we saw opportunities in capacity building. I made a number of trips to China, identified a strategic partner in Suzhou, which is the Silicon Valley of China, the software engineering capital, found a partner in a university, the Global Institute for Software Technology. We signed an agreement with them, And now we're going to do three very important things. One, come this September, we are rolling out a bachelor's degree in software engineering. Those students will spend 2 years in UWI, and they will spend 2 years in China. They will go off to China. And in China, they will be inducted into the technology park of Suzhou, where they will be interned in some of the Fortune 500 companies, all doing the software engineering. And of course, the language of communication will be in Mandarin and English. They will all return to the Caribbean proficient in Mandarin, highly trained in Chinese software engineering and technology. And this is our first step. That first cohort will be enrolled in September, which is 2 months from now. Then we are going to establish the UWI Institute in China, working with our partners. And we are working through at the moment with the Ministry of Education in China, Ministry of Foreign Affairs. All of our ambassadors in Beijing are working with us. And we're doing all of this under the auspices of the China CARICOM Treaty. We are going to build that UWI Institute in Suzhou. Because our partners have expressed an interest in UWI making available to them and the massive Chinese student population American studies, New World studies. And so we will teach them in China Latin American studies, Caribbean studies, North American studies, English, Portuguese, Spanish. We will teach them all the things they need to know about this hemisphere. And this institution will stand proud because in China they will say that we are the one university in China that specializes in American New World Caribbean studies. And that's the quid pro quo. And so we will give them what we're good at, and they will give us what they're good at. And that is how it will go. We have also established a strong relationship with SUNY, the State University of New York, the largest university system in North America, 64 campuses scattered across the state. The chairman of the Board of Trustees, Carl McCall, distinguished citizen, member of the civil rights movement, very good friend. And I said to him, there are millions of Caribbean folk in New York State, all documented. We would like to build a CARICOM SUNY bridge. Our governments have all signed the 17 sustainable goals through their UN relationships. But we need to have an institution that will provide all of the relevant data to our governments on climate change, renewable energy, chronic diseases, mapping agricultural production, developing skill sets for trade policy, trade law. We need to merge our capacity with your capacity. And let us do this in a new and innovative way. And so we have decided to establish a new institution, a jointly owned institution, the SUNY UWI Institute for Sustainable Development and Leadership. And we will develop that in New York to work on behalf of the Caribbean peoples. And I see in the audience here Dr. David Ramprasad, who has been shuttling up and down New York working through the details of this. We're hoping to have that institution established in the second week of September. And so we will see UWI's name on the building in New York and on the building in China. Because this is who we are, a global people a global university, but a university dedicated to service. My final point relates to the moment of time, this ecological moment. If you enter into the technology park of Suzhou, or if you travel through many of the economies that we now call the Asian tigers, what you will see is an intimate spatial relationship between universities, industries, and governments. You will see that there is no space between entrepreneurs, professors, and political leaders, that they bring these forces together, oftentimes in the same space, to drive production, to drive economic diversification. In the Caribbean, the spaces between us are too large. The space between industry and academia is too large. The space between industry and government policy is too large. Between government policy and university thinking is too large. We invited Prime Minister Rowley, when he was in Jamaica, to speak to the entire senior management of the university simultaneously. It was the first time we had done that. It was the first time a Caribbean Prime Minister has had the opportunity to enter into a room and speak to 10 or 15 of the senior managements of the university at St. Augustine, at Mona, at Cave Hill, and the open campus, and speak to us at once and share a vision. That has to become the norm. It has to become the norm. This moment in time requires that we shrink all of these spaces between the factors and the personalities who are responsible for economic transformation and change. We cannot continue like this. I have seen over the years too many wasteful conversations, cross, unnecessary hubris, unnecessary heat. What is required is intimacy. We have to create this intimacy. I've had the pleasure of reading the draft national strategic plan of this country that speaks precisely to this reality. The university has to participate in the implementation of that strategy. We have opportunities. The next stage of our university's development will be the creation of technology parks across the region, innovation centers where we translate our research with venture capital entrepreneurship into products and product design. In Barbados, at the Cave Hill campus, the Sagicor Financial Corporation has leased to the university that very large building in Bridgetown, the old mutual building, beautiful, massive, five-story building. That's the building, as I'm speaking to you right now, our Chinese partners are working in that building, transforming that old building into a technology park for the University of the West Indies. And when you enter that building, you'll be transported into the technology park of Suzhou. This is where our students are going to be receiving instruction from China through the internet on software engineering. We have an opportunity here at Pinal de Bay to participate in the transformation of that enterprise into a technology industry-based campus for this country to drive the issues of economic diversification. These are the things that our university will work with. The government of Jamaica has identified a number of buildings in Kingston, public buildings, abandoned public buildings, that they will make available to the university. We will find the private sector investment to transform those buildings, derelict and whatever they are, into technology parks for incubations. In the next 5 years or so, all of our campuses will be outfitted with technology and incubation parks. This is where we're going. This is how we are going to demonstrate that the university is committed to economic diversification and the transformation of our economies. Our university has to be activists. This is the second phase of our nationhood. This is the second phase of the economic transformation of the Caribbean. And it's a great opportunity for the university. It's an opportunity for the universities, all of the universities in this region, to step up to the plate and say, we are going to re-engineer ourselves to get in the vanguard of economic development in much the same way we were in the vanguard of culture and politics and society and the arts. It's an opportunity. Universities are not built to serve themselves. Universities are built to serve their people. And if they're not seen to be doing this, then the citizens have every right to offer a critique. We are seeking at this time in our strategic planning to enter into a new phase of legitimacy. But you can only win that legitimacy by action. You can only win that legitimacy by action. And we intend to be an activist university. That's the concept we are using in our strategic plan. We're going to be activists whether or not we are responding to the Zika threat, whether we are responding to the impact of hurricanes and earthquakes in our region, whether we're responding to the chronic disease explosion that is going through our communities. We are going to be activists on all of the important fronts that our societies are engaged. And it's through this conversation that we will need your support. This is not a time, therefore, for governments to be cutting the investments in higher education. This is not the time. This is a time for consolidation. This is the time where governments have a right to say, show us that you are using the resources as wisely as we would like you to. Show us that there is productivity in the use of these investments. It is that sense of accountability that will make our university greater and will strengthen the bond with our governments. We are very proud. We are very, very proud that our private sector has stepped up to the plate to university. In all of these islands across the region, the major corporations have stepped up and made enormous investments in our university. Here at St. Augustine campus, at Cave Hill and Jamaica, you see the imprint of the private sector across the landscape. Buildings named in honor of the major investors. Millions of dollars of scholarships to needy students. We are pleased with that relationship. It's growing from strength to strength. The biggest challenge we have at the moment is how to work closely with our governments as they manage their fiscal deficits to enable the university to keep growing, to keep modernizing, to keep expanding. It will not be an easy target, but I believe that intimate conversation, hand in glove, is the way to do it. Everything that has been said in the public can be done in private. I believe it's the kind of diplomacy which our Prime Minister showed when he visited Jamaica, which is to say, there is no need for hubris. Let us sit down as Caribbean citizens and do what is right for our people. I thank you very much for your generosity.
Thank you, Sir Hilary Beckles. You had your triple A and I had triple A when you were speaking. Amazing. Attitude. Awesome. Thank you for your riveting presentation. Thank you. At this time, I'd like to invite the Governor and Sir Hilary, both very fit men, to come back up to the stage because we'd like to make a presentation just to show our appreciation to him. So if you come up so that the cameras could get a good shot. Thank you very much, gentlemen. At this point in time, we would like to present tokens of appreciation to a few people because we know that you took the time from your very, very busy schedules to be here, and we deeply appreciate it. You don't even have to go far. You're just coming forward to the plants in the front, and the presentations will be made to you. So, Governor, once more, I just ask you to step forward right in front of the plants, and I will ask the Honorable Prime Minister, Dr. Keith Rowley, to please come forward. These men look a little alike. Thank you very much, Governor. Governor, one more for me. To Mrs. Sharon Rowley, please come forward. Thank you, Governor. Thank you, Mrs. Rowley. That was the last one. Dr. Sukram, if you can just step in the same spot. And I'd just like the Chief Justice to step forward, the Honorable Justice Ivor Archie. Thank you for gracing us with your presence. Thank you. And Dr. Sukram, stay put. Mrs. Denise Rodriguez Archie, if you can step forward, please. Thank you very much. Mrs. Michelle Chongtai Bell, our acting inspector, if you come forward. It's the same spot, don't be shy. And we're just going to ask the Honorable Orville London, Chief Secretary, to come forward. We always appreciate your presence. Thank you. Did you get it? Did you get the shot? And the last presentation is to the governor's wife. We really thank you for being here. And we'd just like Michelle to make that presentation. It is now my pleasure to invite Dr. Sandra Sukram, Deputy Governor, Monetary Operations and Policy, to deliver a vote of thanks on behalf of the bank. Dr. Sukram.
Dr. the Honorable Keith Rowley, Prime Minister of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago, and Mrs. Sharon Rowley, the Honorable Justice Ivor Archie, Chief Justice of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago, and Mrs. Denise Rodriguez Archie, members of the Cabinet of Trinidad and Tobago, the Honorable Orville London, Chief Secretary, Tobago House of Assembly, Your Excellencies and Heads of Missions and other members of the Diplomatic Corps, members of the Judiciary, Parliamentary Secretaries, Vice Presidents of the Senate, Deputy Speaker of the House of Representatives, members of the Senate and of the House of Representatives, Secretaries of the Tobago House of Assembly, Permanent Secretaries, Mayors of City Corporations, Professors Sir Hilary Beckles, Vice Chancellor of the University of the West Indies, and our distinguished lecturer. Mrs. Sheila Hilaire, the Governor's spouse, Board of Directors, Management, and staff of the Central Bank of Trinidad and Tobago, former Governors of the Central Bank, Dr. Eurip Bob and Mr. T. Ainsworth Harewood, former Deputy Governors of the Central Bank, Mr. Jerry Hospitalis, Ms. Joan John, Dr. Shelton Nichols, and Mrs. Janice Christopher Nichols, family and friends of Dr. Eric Williams, students and teachers from the Holy Faith Convent, Coover, and Queen's Royal College, Port of Spain, members of the media, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, good evening. I am honored to have been asked to give the vote of thanks on this occasion, the 30th edition of the Dr. Eric Williams Memorial Lecture. On behalf of the Board of Directors and Management of the Central Bank, I extend a very warm and hearty thank you to this year's presenter, Sir Hilary Beckles, for sharing his important work and perspectives with us tonight on the topic, the university sector and economic development in the Caribbean. Sir Beckles, your presentation was thought-provoking and demonstrated your deep commitment to the development of our Caribbean region. We were looking forward to a riveting and dynamic lecture, and we were not disappointed. You surpassed even our highest expectations. I also thank the students who attended this lecture. What you have heard would no doubt have a positive impact on your lives. The interest and the enthusiasm you have shown by coming to this event, even during your school vacation, is indeed a good sign that our future is in safe care. Special thanks to Mrs. Beverly Samuel Thomas of the Ministry of Foreign and CARICOM Affairs, who along with her efficient team provided exceptional support. My heartfelt appreciation to all personnel of the bank who worked so hard to put together this event. To each and everyone who contributed to tonight's occasion, thanks for your dedication and your commitment. Ladies and gentlemen, when you leave this auditorium, you will be able to enjoy an exhibition honoring the past presenters of this lecture. And we are grateful to the following institutions and people for allowing us access to material regarding Dr. Eric Williams. The University of the West Indies Alma Jordan Library, West Indiana Special Collections, the Eric Williams Memorial Collection, and Mrs. Erica Williams-Connell. We sincerely appreciate the support of our efforts given by past Dr. Eric Williams Memorial speakers and stewards of their estates for providing photographs for the exhibition. Thanks so much to the Bosco Holder Estate and the 101 Art Gallery for giving the permission to make prints of a painting by Bosco Holder from our art collection. Let me express once more the bank's wholehearted gratitude to Sir Beckles and all of you who accepted our invitation to attend this remarkable event. We are greatly honored. I will now leave you in the capable hands of Mrs. Crooks, who will conclude this part of the evening. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sandra. Okay, at this point in time, we are going to proceed to the foyer on the ground floor, but with just a little bit of instructions. So on the screen behind me, you will be able to stay here in the comfort of your seats if you would like to view the opening of the exhibition. If not, at any rate, what we need to do is to allow a few people to leave the auditorium first and make their way to go downstairs, after which...